25th Anniversary Committee, the Bass Harbor Library, and the Tremont Historical Society. Ruth Moore's niece, Muriel Davison, who's one of the readers today, and I attended a fully staged production of this play at the Opera House in Stonington. I think it was 2018 or 19?
18.
Yeah. We loved it, and ever since have wanted to see it performed on MDI, where Ruth made her home. But then the pandemic hit, and this dream had to be put on hold until now. We are thrilled to be doing this abridged reading, four of the seven stories of I Have Seen Horizons, and hope one day soon to produce the complete and fully staged play. Meg Tainter and Natalia Blagdiga clearly had a reverence for Ruth Moore when they wrote this play. The words are taken verbatim from Ruth's stories, which you will, which is why at times you'll hear characters talking about themselves in the third person. And occasionally I'll read stage directions, so you'll get kind of an idea of what we saw. We want to thank everyone who volunteered their time and effort into making this happen, with a special thanks to the Southwest Harbor Tremont Chamber of Commerce for printing out our scripts and programs. They're big scripts, and this is only four of the seven. We hope you enjoy this, and don't be shy about asking us to speak up if you're having trouble hearing. We've only rehearsed with our indoor voices. please turn off your cell phones and whatever devices you've got with you, and we're going to begin. And Gus and Matthias, if you could play us a little opening music, softly. When the house opens, musicians and actors are already gathered in the space. Some are playing music and singing, some are getting ready, setting props, costume pieces, etc. Some are just watching the others sing. They may greet the audience as they enter. The atmosphere is relaxed. Gradually, the players finish getting ready for the performance and gather on stage.
Folks down around Lisbon, Maine can hardly wait for Thursday to see what the Enterprise has to say about them. And all over the country, subscribers to this amazing four-page weekly are just as interested.
Maybe it's because, as some folks said to John Gould, editor of the Enterprise,
your items are so local, they're universal.
John had always wanted to run a newspaper on this theory.
In 1945, he got the opportunity.
Charles F. Mann, who owned and run the Enterprise for 56 years, died suddenly in the night. Mr. Mann was 87. He'd been working down in the paper the day before. The week's copy was about half set up, but his widow felt too bad to finish it alone.
John heard about her trouble. He'd had some new newspaper experience, so he came down from the farm to let her get out the paper. The Lisbon Enterprise interested him a lot, particularly when Mrs. Mann wanted to sell. Down in the dusty offices under the Oddfellows Hall, John got to thinking.
The paper had a subscription list of 268. Mr. Mann had been content just to job along, printing local news as he heard about it, and such advertising as came his way.
In John's opinion, most hometown papers were pretty stodgy affairs. Editors wrote about the commonplace events of the village with a colorless, uninflected, run-of-the-mill language, as if it were a chore to produce the paper. They got people's names in.
A fine fundamental principle.
But who cared except those same people or maybe their relations? When an editor, what an editor should do was to make the distinction between getting in names and getting in personalities.
Life in a small town was no less than the raw material of most literature. If a paper were edited to reflect it, there ought to be no limit to circulation.
Among other items, John remembered about his friend, Jess Goud.
The best printer on the Atlantic coast, to John's way of thinking, if not in the world.
Jess knew how to print red successfully. Not that this was a prerequisite for a small town paper, but any paper will know what it means.
Together, they had enough money, so they bought the paper.
Shortly, along with the usual news that somebody visited up to Lewiston Saturday, Enterprise readers began to notice items which were different, to say the least. Under a heading, Bubblegum Makes a Good Anesthetic, came the story of two little boys who crashed head-on while ice skating.
Teddy had a cut over the left eyebrow, and Calvin over the right. Their hair was mussed, and blood coursed down their faces. The cuts necessitated 5 stitches each. Asked if he'd had a local anesthetic, Teddy replied he really didn't know. He'd been blowing bubble gum while the wound was being stitched.
There were such items as...
The Harrison Fosters say it was so miserable Sunday, they didn't go out and nobody came in.
Two heavy blankets are warmer than one thin one and cost more.
Philip Lawrence's dog sat with Jack Wednesday evening. Bucky gets lonely if left alone and disturbs the neighbors.
In too much of a hurry to get out of town, Victor Morin of Lisbon misjudged the WPA curve on Gould Street last Saturday and put his car in the ditch with a bump that brought the neighbors a running. This is the first mishap at this point since the state belatedly installed a large warning sign. But most people who know the road think the fault for accuracy lies with those who made the road and not the sign or no sign.
Everybody who had any picked peas and strawberries after the rain and bragged.
Adam died long, long ago.
That last item was one of a number that created considerable interest.
John said he figured it would when somebody would phone in and say, "What the hell, John?" He'd say, "I had an idea somebody might call up about that. When I printed it, I was kind of lonesome."
And then they'd get to talking, and while John might not get a subscription out of the fellow, he did quite often get a nice item for the paper.
What John was doing was running the chatty, homespun, joshing sort of thing that actually goes on in a town.
A small town is the common denominator of every other town. The idea being that most people are neighborly if they stop to think about it.
From the beginning, the new Enterprise, as a few sour souls phrased it, nosed into town business.
Whenever there was a story about the school, or the roads, or the stink in the river, John printed it.
One year, he printed the list of taxpayers paying over $20. Of course, the tax list is always available to anyone who wants to go around and look at it, but few do.
It's a healthy thing in any town to know what taxes the neighbors pay.
Some people in town liked the bombshell type of reporting. Some didn't.
Of course, there were always people in any town who don't like anything.
One man got so mad that he swore he'd never open a copy of the Enterprise again. The next week, oddly enough, there was a news item about him. And for some reason, his name got misspelled. It seems that 5 minutes after the paper came out, he was on the phone pointing out the error.
A feature of the paper is its item of the week. It is boxed on the front page.
Since the barn on the Marguerite Pool Place was torn down, the selectmen have an uninterrupted view of Dr. William Spears' back porch.
Jim Farah and Edna found a turtle making its way across the road. Edna took him home and put him in a tub to the edification of the neighborhood children.
Mrs. Frances Upton has one hen sitting on 4 eggs and one sitting on 2.
The hens were canaries. It was a disappointment to read in the news column later.
The hen canary sitting on 4 eggs at the Upham home fell short in her duties when they hatched because they all died. The hen sitting on 2 now has 5.
There's no telling what will turn up in the Enterprise.
In reporting a hard winter, there was the usual case of Homer Belcher, who had the temerity to shovel out his front yard with a steel snow shovel and became fouled with a high tension line.
The shovel instantly turned white hot and sizzled down through the snow to the ground. Homer with it. And it took the whole neighborhood to dig him out. He is all right, but he's still lit up quite good, and his family uses him to read by the in the evenings. And is saving the monthly electric bill. The doctor says he should glow about 200 watts right up into July, and then will gradually taper off. And then they could use him for a bug light in the bathroom until about Labor Day.
Weddings and funerals and school and church meetings are covered with sober Maine honesty, and state and national affairs may be handled with no more chattiness than the New York Times.
But it's the Nor'easter touch that the foreign subscribers like best. When the Maine nimble-witted legislators were hitting on all 16 cylinders, trying to decide whether or not they ought to take vacation land off the license plate, John's editorial said,
"We feel it is a crying shame for anybody in Maine to get so all-fired commercialized he couldn't think of anything better to call a good old state than vacation land. Maine might be vacation land to a good many tired city people who had weeks and enough money to buy gasoline, souvenirs, and a shore dinner, but we find it enjoyable to live in these parts the year round. And Maine appeals to us mostly when it isn't vacation land to very many at once."
To this rule is Miss Peterson. Once she steps into that role, she will remain for the duration of the story.
On an island a mile or so off the main coast, overlooking the sea from Point of Rock, is a stone foundation of a house.
Some rubbish lies about. Not much left now by a generation of souvenir hunters.
A dented kitchen pan, bits of thin china, glass oxidized by fire and sun. A kitchen stove lies half buried in ashes.
On the northern wall and creeping slowly across along the stones from east to west as the years go by is thick woodbine, green in spring and summer. In October, a shawl of clear red, bright as courage against the electric blue of that sea.
Those in the island village who remember when the house was built.
My grandfather was one of the workmen.
Can still repeat some of the terse comments made at the idea of skill and good materials going into it.
Granted, the summer people were all as crazy as loons, and most of them built their houses on the east side of the island to be out from underfoot of the natives. Their houses had always been set back, at least a little, from the shore among the trees.
This flub-dub of a house hadn't even a gable to split the wind. It had a mansard roof and a flat expanse of wall reared up to the naked east, as uncompromising as a stubborn woman's chin.
Well, a stubborn woman had built it.
She wanted a tough little house and a view of the sea. The workmen grumbled, but when the place was finished, it was built to last and as tight as a ship.
Come a good easterly.
My grandfather would say, even years after.
She won't wash off of there, but I wouldn't want to be surprised if she had dumped some salt water out of her drawers. Bureau drawers, I meant. And while she's hanging them out to dry, she can look to her view.
Look at her view, she certainly could. Her north windows faced 3 or so miles of water and the Mount Desert Mountains. The rounded hills set down one after the other as in a drawing by a humorous child. She had come there for the North Atlantic, stretching from the ledges outside her window to the sky.
I doubt if she ever knew that, because she defied Down East custom. She was never able to live down her reputation among us of being slightly cracked.
She would have been distressed, I think, if she had known, for she would have liked to receive the same kindness and respect that she gave.
But her east windows were always streaked with salt. In a full gale, the flower pots washed off her porch, and the sea sent streaming runnels of foam across the lawn, so that the ledge on which the house stood became an island all her own.
Her name was Elizabeth Peterson. She was known in the beginning, when she and her mother and friends stayed on the island, only as one of the Philadelphia ladies.
I don't know what her real background was,
but the gossip around the village went that she was the daughter of the owner of Peterson's magazine, published in Philadelphia in the 80s.
Her father was dead, and the magazine too. And somehow, somewhere, her family had lost a great deal of money.
In the early days, when a dollar would stretch, Miss Peterson and her mother undoubtedly had a comfortable income. But they hired jobs done about their place, and sometimes had a girl to help around the house.
But following the war, during the last part of Miss Peterson's life, her income was smaller than even we on the island cared to think about.
We couldn't help knowing what it was, for my father had the general store and the post office, and he cashed her checks.
If she had looked like other people, she might have shaken down into some kind of accepted familiarity.
Perhaps have become one of us as the years went by.
But she did not look like other people, and she never would shake down into familiarity. Facts that she must have known.
She was the most calamitously homely person I have ever seen in my life. The reason she built her house in such a lonely spot was because she wanted to keep out of the way where she could not be often seen.
So we said. We were then still critical of the house built where the gales could sweep it.
And unhappy because we needed a more sensible reason than just that Miss Peterson wished to look at a view.
We were not cruel, I think, for the sake of being so. We must only have been very unsure of ourselves.
The island was a mile off the coast and 30 miles from a city.
For 9 months of the year, we saw only each other.
We did our shopping for nearly everything but food from the Sears Roebuck or Montgomery Ward catalogs.
We were sensitive, as only an isolated people can be.
Suspicious of outlanders.
Even of the minister and the school teacher, who, though they were always people of our own kind from the mainland, were still from away.
I hope that Miss Peterson never knew that we made fun of her behind her back. If she did know it, she never once in all the years showed that she did.
Her manner to us all, young and old, was always cheerfully friendly.
She had trivial conversation for everybody, speaking in her jerky voice about
the weather.
About
the mail being late.
About
the beauties of nature.
And I think there was never a single time when one of us was not polite to her face, answering her trivialities in kind, telling her news of the outside world when we had it, which was seldom in the wintertime.
where she was there in the wintertime after the first few years, she and her mother, and neither of them ever lived anywhere else again.
When the first September came around that they did not close up their house and go away, the village speculated, then wondered.
October rolled by. As always, a succession of fine days full of thick gold sunshine, as if the sun were swollen with heat that could not reach the earth.
The Petersons did not go. Finally, November came and the first bit of snow.
My father would have died rather than nose into anyone's affairs, particularly one of the summer people. I can remember his throat-clearing embarrassment one day as he handed Miss Peterson's mail through the wicket and said,
staying late this year, ain't you?
She looked up from her handful. She always got a lot of mail. With her quick smile,
this is our home now. We're not going away.
I knew my father was flabbergasted from the way he hesitated.
Won't you be lonesome way off down there?
Oh, no, no, no. I've never been lonesome in my life. I've plenty to do.
I guess you will have. Snow gets deep, you know, in them woods.
Oh, I love the snow and the cold weather. Good day, Mr. Moore. Such lovely weather. This fall sunshine is just...
It won't last. But the door was already closing behind her slim, straight back.
She was quite likely to walk away from you while she was still talking, so that the meaningless sentences seldom came to a full stop, but died away in the distance.
The village was shocked and uneasy.
Particularly the men.
Our main men had a very low opinion of the capabilities of women.
A fact which always struck me as strange, since they were quite willing to let us lug wood and shovel snow if we felt inclined, though not to undertake enterprises of our own.
The idea of two women stuck out on that bleak cliff, a mile and a half from a living soul, it wasn't sensible.
It wasn't even safe.
It was flying in the face of Providence.
How could they keep warm in that fool house with the temperature 20 below and a gale blowing?
Who would lug the wood and coal?
Who would lug the water?
My mother asked Miss Peterson that question on the day when she tried in vain to persuade her to take a vacant house in the village for the winter.
Well, I'll tell you, Lizzie will lug it.
She always called herself Lizzie. When she talked to herself, as she often did, she sometimes said,
Lizzie, you old fool.
Suppose something should happen. What if you have to have help quick?
Nothing will happen to us. We'll be snug. The worse the storm is, the better we like it. We'll take things as they come.
The closing door shut out the sound of her voice.
And so, through the years of my childhood and youth, our winter times were accented by the thought of Miss Peterson and her mother.
And later, Miss Peterson alone.
On the shelf of rock, a mile and a half from anybody.
We took wind and weather pretty seriously, our menfolk being fishermen. If anyone didn't, we said, it was because she didn't know any better.
But as the years went by, and we realized the kind of stubbornness she had, our low, reluctant respect for her began to be replaced with admiration.
She tried her best to persuade us not to bother about her. She had a horror of being a nuisance.
Often she plowed through the snow to the village when she didn't need to come, for fear we would send someone over to the head to make sure she was all right.
She always came if she could get through the snow on the day after a heavy storm, that being the time when people were likely to worry.
And the worry was legitimate. The road to the head was a little more than a cart track, studded in rooted knobs and stones, and in the dark, the section across the neck was dangerous.
The path in those days ran along the south bank, in some places 3 or 4 feet from the edge. In a full gale, the wind made a funnel of that narrow, naked strip of land. sucking across with blasts that could take a man off his feet.
My God,
my grandfather said.
You let a good gust get up under them skirts of him, and she'd be off there in a balloon like a balloon.
There were a few occasions when Miss Peterson did not turn up in the village when she was expected.
When that happened, two of the men would get into sheepskin coats and rubber boots and go across the island to her house.
From the remarks they made about that senseless woman, you would have thought they were setting out on a journey to a home for the feeble-minded in Iceland.
But they would always tuck her mail carefully in their pockets, gather up a gift of fish or lobsters or a quart of milk, and they never failed to take along snow shovels.
They would cuss and growl all the way across the island.
But arrived at Miss Peterson's house.
Had to see how many lobster traps washed ashore last night. So we brought along your mail.
Or
Frank and me was looking if the snow was too deep to haul wood.
No mention of the gifts, which were dropped casually on the table as of no account.
No mention whatever of the real reason for coming.
They never knew how she felt about being a bother.
They would then shovel her path to the well, fill up all available buckets and containers with drinking water, bring in coal, heap the wood boxes.
When they had done everything that they could think of, they would announce that, well, they guess they'd better be getting along home.
Oh, no, no, no. You must come in and have some cake and coffee.
She would set them down in easy chairs in her comfortable living room before the crackling open fire with big plates of devil's food cake and some of the coffee she had hustled to put on when she spotted them coming out into her clearing.
They would sit there, uncomfortable at first, drinking the coffee out of a fragile spode cup, their sheepskins unbuttoned tightly, their caps on the floor beside their chairs.
Then, after a bit, one of them might open his coat and shrug it off his shoulders and stretch out his feet, and the other would follow suit.
Bits of village news would pass, whatever there was. Nothing much exciting to tell.
Miss Peterson would bustle around, bringing more cake, filling the cups, putting in a word and a here and another word there.
Until presently, all three of them were laughing and talking 10 to a dozen.
Before they left, Miss Peterson would make her own little excuse why she hadn't come to the village.
I was finishing my rug, and it was so interesting, I forgot it was man day.
Or,
I was just putting on my galoshes when you came out of the woods.
Never a word about the fact that she had gotten too tired shoveling snow, or that she, somehow, didn't feel quite well that day.
I don't think anybody fooled anybody.
The men would get up to go, and all the way across the island, they would cuss and groan about the bother and the waste of time.
They liked it, of course.
After she had lived for a few years among us, we had found out that she loved to entertain. Her food was superb and better than anyone I ever knew. She could put people at ease.
The stage is subtly transformed. It becomes more elegant, a place of wonder and surprises, bigger than it was before, glittering and celebratory.
I don't know when she started to give her Christmas parties. Two each year, one for children, one for grown-ups. I cannot, it seems, remember a Christmas season without them. I must have gone to them from the time my parents considered me old enough to walk to the head and back again with the other children at 10 o'clock at night. They were.
Wait a second. Let's go let them sing a song.
This is a song.
Oh, but
they were They were lovely parties of a kind we didn't know, beginning slowly when all sat in our best clothes around Miss Peterson's living room, talking in subdued voices and taking surreptitious peeks at her things, building up through games to a sumptuous supper of ice cream and cake and presents under her tree.
They were never very expensive presents. I remember my disdain one year when I got a pine cone with a red ribbon on it. But it was a very beautiful, symmetrical pine cone. And I wish I had it now.
I don't think there was ever a Christmas tree so beautiful as Miss Peterson's. At least I've never seen one. Though perhaps I saw it through the eyes of children. Our own trees were trimmed with cranberry and popcorn strings, a little tinsel sometimes, and colored balls when we could get them. Hers had on it every kind of small bright fragment and miniature toy.
It was almost more wonderful that she had cut the tree and set it up and trimmed it herself, and that she had made cake and frozen ice cream for 20 children.
But we did not think of that then. We only ate it, and afterwards we broke down and had bad manners and did things like dipping napkins into water glasses and throwing them.
The grown-ups' party was quite a different affair. It was formal, the kind of dinner party I know now that Miss Peterson would have given to her Philadelphia friends had they been within reach.
How she could do that and still put us at ease was something to be wondered at.
But she managed it, and we liked it. I used to go to her house often, for as she grew older, she seemed not to mind if children brought the milk and the mail on wet and snowy days. She was always glad to lend the books with which her living room was lined.
She had a many-volume nature encyclopedia with lovely colored illustrations. And she tried getting us interested in knowing the names of birds and grasses and mushrooms.
There was a book called The Sea Children, which I have never seen anywhere else, though I have tried to find it, about a family of fabulous princes with gills who lived under the sea, rode dolphins, and warned against the denizens of the deep.
She herself read what, to me, were dreadfully dry books, history and travel. But I remember one time I surprised her in the middle of Tarzan and the Apes.
It was a very remarkable book.
It was never very much fun to talk to her. She had the same empty conversation for children that she had for grown-ups. I remember only once seeing below that surface. I had brought over her mail, and she looked at the newspaper and saw the headline that Richard Harding Davis was dead. She gave a little cry, and tears came into her eyes.
Oh, and he had been so many places.
And every night, for 30 years, she left a lamp burning in her east window until dawn.
It was as faithful as a lighthouse, and it became one.
The fishermen coming home late at night or before daylight always took their bearings by it and called it Miss Peterson's light.
So there she was with her kindliness, her eccentric ways that made us laugh, her stubbornness that made us mad. How mad sometimes, I shouldn't like to say.
She seemed stranger and more eccentric as she grew older. Perhaps she was.
Solitude and loneliness do queer things sometimes.
It didn't occur to us that it might have been these which were responsible for her last and most outrageous piece of stubbornness.
Her everlasting pig-headedness, we called it.
The church on the island was Methodist. A small, cold little building with straight-backed seats and a naked pulpit rearing at the front.
There we were accustomed to hear on one Sunday a month, which was as often as the Methodist Conference could spare a minister, sermons of hellfire and brimstone. It was, all in all, a pretty bleak proposition.
The Ulsters of the village were proud of this church, for in their young days, they had worked hard to get it.
Our grandfathers sometimes took us up to the belfry and showed us the nails that they had hammered with their own hands into the timbers.
Miss Peterson had always gone to the Methodist church, and so the village was incredulous and mad when she came right out one summer and said her own people had been Episcopalian.
She needed something more now than the Methodists had to offer. She said she was going to build an Episcopal church.
Well, we said to each other.
The Methodists always been good enough for us.
And?
What can you expect of them summer people?
Miss Peterson had then lived among us for 20 years.
Nobody believed her. We knew that outside of her living expenses, she didn't have 2 cents to rub together.
Aunt Pete's as crazy as a loon, we said.
We should have known better.
For 2 years, she scraped and she scrounged. She wrote to the Episcopalians in the mainland summer resorts. She talked to people into giving a penny here and a dollar there. And somehow, by hook or by crook, she got a movement started.
The wealthy summer people in the resorts all at once thought it would be lovely to give a little church to the fisher folk on the remote island.
A neighbor of ours, with his tongue in his cheek, sold Miss Peterson a half acre of land near the main road in the village.
And one summer morning, we were thunderstruck when a lumber scout delivered a load at the island and the carpenters came to start building.
We would have been all right if somebody hadn't started the argument as to whether it was idolatrous to get up and kneel down during a service.
People took sides and tempers rose.
My father said it wasn't as if the Methodists or the Episcopals amounted to a damn as long as it was religion.
It was just that we hadn't had a good row for years and we were ready for it. That didn't prevent old friends from passing on the other side of the road with their noses in the air, half for the Methodists and half for the Episcopalians.
For the beauty of the earth, for the glory of the skies, for the love from which our birth over and around us lies. Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise.
Miss Peterson was in seventh heaven for weeks after her church was built.
When the novelty wore off and the summer people went away, she had very little congregation.
Often, when the rector could get over from the mainland, which was not often, he and she held services alone.
Then, one by one, the children began to go, out of curiosity and because on the island, there was nothing else to go to.
After a time, one or two of the children, and finally a few younger grown-ups, were baptized by the rector, and the Episcopals were in.
Miss Peterson's church was, in the beginning, quite an ugly little building, rather like a new garage. Inside, it was raw with yellow wood. The day the carpenters moved out, she moved in.
She spent her daylight hours planting cuttings from her rose bushes along the foundations and in front of them bulbs and sets from her own magnificent garden. She wheeled her lawnmower across the island and cut the stiff field grass again and again until the lawn came up fine and green. For 3 years, she worked to make a hooked rug out of silk scraps in tiny, delicate loops.
It made a rich stream of color up the middle aisle of the church and in front of the altar.
In some curious way, it brought mellowness out in the wood, out of thin, amber-stained glass of the windows.
Over the altar, she laid lengths of colored cloth embroidered with millions of perfect stitches.
It took her years to finish the church. The new wood darkened in time into a pleasant background. The whole had a dignity and quietude, but more than anything else, warmth.
It is true that during the last years of her life, she was very frail. And it is true that she was deeply religious.
For the rest, she plagues the mind, as those people do about whom nothing personal is known. Without doubt, she was lonely, a woman deeply creative, who needed some of the world's work to do.
Perhaps building a church was a last desperate attempt to bridge the gulf between herself and the only human being she saw from day to day. All other things had failed. I do not know.
I think I do know why she lived at the island, away from her kind, alone. The year I was a junior in college, a friend of Miss Peterson's left her a legacy.
It couldn't have been much, but it was enough, she said, to go on a trip.
She hadn't been away from the island in 25 years, and this was perhaps the last chance she'd get to see the world.
She was in her 70s that year. I think 74.
When I went back to school at the end of Christmas vacation, she was on the train. There she was, in a day coach, sitting straight as an arrow, dressed in the same shabby black clothing and hat that she wore on the island, except for a piece of cleaned yellow lace at her throat.
She was watching through the frosty windows the bleak little towns of Maine pull away and be left behind in the dusk and the steam from the engine.
Her eyes were bright, and her face was full of suppressed excitement. She didn't seem like someone who had spent years in hiding because she didn't want anyone to look at her.
This now was what she had loved and longed for. Travel in the world, people, things going on.
And suddenly I saw that the only home she had was on the island. The only roof left when the others owned by her family were gone. There only could she live on her tiny income without asking someone for help. So much for our neighbor who always seemed to know, and for the others who had it over on sewing afternoons.
The winter that followed was long and cold. In February, the island had 3 feet of snow on the level, deeper in the woods. The temperature went on some mornings to 20 below.
There was still talk of doing something about Aunt Pete, but the talk was second nature now, and nobody really thought seriously of actually getting her to move into the village until spring. She was 75, but she wasn't missing trips after the mail.
She came in one bleak afternoon just before dark, and my mother, handing her letters, noticed that her hands were shaking.
Don't you feel well, Miss Peterson?
Oh, yes, thank you. I'm cold, though. I can't seem to get warm. I'll go home and shake up my coal stove and have a hot drink.
Stay and have some supper. Afterwards, one of the boys will walk home with you.
Oh, no, thank you very much. It's going to snow, I think, and I don't want to be too late.
The closing door hid the rest of it.
And my mother saw her go past the window towards the woods, her erect figure in its somber clothes, dark against the snow.
The next morning was a little warmer.
It had snowed in the night, and when my mother went out to hang her dish towels on the porch,
she saw thick smoke rising over the trees. She thought nothing of it, because the men had been cutting wood in the woodlot the day before, and they had burned brush.
At noon, two of the men started out in their boat to go to one of the other islands.
As they chugged out past the head, they could see beyond its thick trees. They saw that Miss Peterson's house was gone. that the smoke was rising from the place where it had been.
They put back to their mooring and rowed ashore, running white-faced up through the village and stopping at each house on the way.
The word traveled fast. Everyone who could walk or didn't have young children started on the run from wherever he was to the head.
It wasn't a question of gathering, for nobody waited.
Nobody even stopped to say, "This is what we always said would happen."
The whole village just went silently and sick at heart down through the snowy woods.
The foundations of the house were red hot and filled with blazing embers.
The men couldn't tell, but they judged it had burned sometime after midnight, when the village was sound asleep in its snug western rooms, their windows blinded by frost.
No one nearby saw what must have been a scene of mysterious grandeur and incredible loneliness. The stretch of the stormy sea to the east, lighted along its fringe by the flames, the bleak rocks and the laden spruces, red glare upon the swirling snow.
Around the house, the snow had melted, but beyond the heat, it was white and unbroken. There were no tracks coming away.
White against his tan and against the rich green of the leaves behind him.
His uniform was of a private's, but the splendid cap in his hand had a visor, the kind officers wear.
A Maine kid doesn't use a hat much this time of year. He's enjoying being bareheaded again, I thought. But he put the cap on as he came closer, very likely so he could tip it to a lady as a proper soldier should.
Well, hello!
A note or so higher, and his voice would have broken like a 13-year-old's. Hello yourself! How are you? I was poking hastily around in my memories of the lanky kids of the town. I had been away myself for 3 years, and they grow up so. This boy had me puzzled. Most of the Maine men, particularly the young ones, no matter how, when you saw them last, say hi laconically in greeting and nod one or two little bobs of the head. If it's to a woman, they don't shake hands until she puts her hand out first. Maybe this isn't a local boy, I thought. Must be someone I've met somewhere else.
I guess you don't remember me so good.
I guess I do. I was just surprised to see you grown up. That was safe because 3 years ago, this kid couldn't have been much over 15. 17 at the most.
Well,
he was through with me. He had been glad to see me, and I hadn't remembered him. Now he was trying to think of something final to say so he could go.
I guess we wasn't on good terms when we saw each other last.
Yeah, I guess not. Which of the youngsters had run afoul of me 3 years ago? But I never saw the grudge I could hold 3 years, did you? That, I said to myself, was about the damnedest fool thing you've ever said in your life. Whoever this boy is, wherever he's been, he's just come home from a war. Maybe one day you'll get it into your head for good that there's a war on.
Well, when I came in for it, I wanted to see the teacher.
One of my sister's boys. Before she'd been married, she taught for a long time in the high school. Sure, she's inside. Come on in.
Why, Joe. Joey Hinckley.
Hi.
It's nice to see you. You've been gone, what, 2, 3? Where have you been all this long time?
Oh, I've been all over. Pearl Harbor, the Solomons, mostly Guadal.
I knew you were at Pearl Harbor. Your mother was worried for a long time after because she didn't hear from you.
It took a long time to get word through. So that's your baby?
Why, yes. I got married after you graduated, the summer after you graduated, Joe, to Harlan Peters. I've got another baby, nearly 2, a little girl.
I'd never graduated, remember? I quit school and enlisted the spring of my senior year, and I ain't been home since then.
Of course. I remember I tried to get you to wait until June, and you wouldn't.
That's right.
But you could see he was hurt because she hadn't remembered exactly. Oh, I knew him now, all right. The skinny, toe-headed little devil he was, with wisecracks to shrivel you right at the tip of his tongue. I remembered the early November night when we got
not on
good
terms.
A night crisp with frost, a full moon, and the best of the northern spy apples that I'd left on the tree because they taste better with a touch of frost on them. I was planning to hand-pick them the next day, and that night, I happened to glance out an upstairs window, and here was some scallywag up a tree. I went out the front door, sneaked around the barn, and arrived at the foot of the tree. When he slid down with his blouse and pockets full, I grabbed him by the collar and shaking apples in all directions. Joey Hinckley was slight and his bones under my hands felt like bird bones. But he was pretty indomitable even in those days. He landed a full kick on my shin and I howled and sat flat down.
Yo, Applehog! Oh, Applehog with a big nose!
He was gone before I could pull in my breath. A supple shadow in the moonlight, his sound a light rustling over the frost-crisped grass. I remember sitting there, madder as Joey had known I'd be over the reference to my practical-sized nose than I was over the apples or the whack on the shin. Now, here he was, home from his wanderings and foreign wars, sitting in our kitchen. On his knees, the visor cap he probably bought with his own money to dress him up for his coming home.
I didn't know you'd been married. He'd been gone a long time, and he wanted to pick up where he'd left off, but nothing changed. Some things had changed. Not the main village, but that's been the same in June for 150 years. The same high sky with big clouds ballooning over, the arm of the sea slicking up past it, blue and hazy in the afternoon, the white houses folded in against the hill. Except for the tide going in and out and the season and the weather, the village doesn't change.
But different people are born and grow up and die. And Private Joe Hinckley couldn't seem to catch up with them.
You saw some fighting, I guess, John.
Why, yes, I did.
Was it bad?
Got tough sometimes. Them Japs, they don't give up easy.
You got your arm all right?
Well, I got my arm scraped in some of the ruckus. Had some malaria, but not bad.
I could see that she wanted to ask him more about what it had really been like.
You do, you know, when they come back. But somehow it's hard to phrase the question. Does it seem good to be home?
Oh, I'll say. Don't seem as if I good people knows people's goods I used to. And most of the boys my age, they're gone in the Army or the Navy.
The girls, too, a lot of them, got jobs away.
Hey. Well, I'd better be on my way. It sure seems funny that you keep married with two kids and me not even knowing that.
Well, time goes by, and you know, Joe, I think it's kind of, I like it.
Oh, sure. Swell. He did not think it was swell. He wanted things the same as when he'd left.
As his teacher, she meant something to him. Well, Lord knows what. It's hard to figure what a teacher ever does mean to a harum-scarum youngster. Maybe something she taught him had been of use to him out where he'd been. Whatever it was, now he was just another married woman.
Well, so long.
So long, Joe. Drop by again if you have time.
Sure will.
I knew it was better to leave things alone, but I took out after him. It isn't done in a main village for a bespectacled middle-aged lady to take out running down a driveway after a boy of 20. I could see he thought that, but he waited politely until I caught up with him. Joe, how long are you home for?
10 days.
Have a good time on your leave, Joe. Find the prettiest girl in town. She'll be proud to go out with a soldier.
Thanks.
Joe, once in the city, in the hard times, I was looking for a job and ran out of money. I didn't eat for most 3 days. It was tough. Not like a war, I know that. But all I could think of one night was spy apples. How they crackle when you bite into them.
Gee, I did that one night in the jungle. I got to thinking about that, and I nearly liked to die. Did you?
I sure did. I got so homesick, I bawled like a calf. The tree's in blossom now. Yeah, I kind of wish it was November, Joe. You could have all the apples you could lug away.
I sure have the juice running down my chin. It doesn't change much, does it?
It doesn't change at all, Joe.
Well, look, I got this.
The ribbon glinted in the bright sun. I don't know soldiers' medals, but it was the Distinguished Service Cross, I think. Anyway, the words on it were for valor. The underside of his arm wasn't tan, and along it ran a livid scar where the flesh had been ripped and shredded. I just looked. I couldn't say anything. Then I said, How do you do it, Joe?
Oh, the scar, that's shrapnel. When a bomb or a shell explodes, pieces of iron will, like, fly around.
Oh. Couldn't you wear it on the outside, Joe, so folks would know?
Well, my own folks do know. But you know how the neighbors are, what they'd say. Oh, Joe's own. Guess he thinks he's something going around all trimmed up like a Christmas tree.
He was right. That was just what they and we had drilled into us from the time we could understand words. Don't put yourself forward. It's kind of cheap. Born in the flesh and bred in the bone. The year I myself was 20, I published a poem in a little magazine. Dead now these many years, both poem and magazine forgotten. Yeah, it wasn't much. Not like the things of war, but I remember how I wanted people to know. They never did. For whenever it was on my lips to tell, I kept hearing the neighbors. Oh, yeah, she thinks she's something. Bragging about her writing being printed somewhere southwestern. Oh, I know what Joe meant, all right. Joe, I'll tell my sister if you like it. I'll tell everyone. I'll say, I saw that pin in your pocket and made you tell me what it was you had there.
Gee, I guess so, if you put it like that. I kind of would like to have folks know.
He went away down the line of horse chestnuts, walking a little stiffly, his cap carried carefully in his hand. A Maine kid this time of year hasn't much use for a hat.
That story in the old town. Some people I had a good time. Nobody
were born within 2 hours of each other. They went to school and grew up in the same island village, fought the same battles, and bowed the same girls. When they got big enough to handle a fishing boat, they rivaled each other for the heaviest hauls of fish. As a young man, my grandfather went away to sea.
Well, he became skipper of fishing schooners out of Gloucester to the Grand Banks, and to a three-sticker from Nova Scotia to Boston. He was thrifty, he put money by, and when he retired from the sea at 68, he came home, bought himself a nice boat, and went lobstering.
Foley stayed at the island and went lobstering all his life. Fat year lean, he never saved a cent. His boat was an old black lapstreak double-ender with a two-cylinder, two-cycle Mianus engine. Through the years, Foley patched up this engine, when necessary, using wire, old nuts and bolts.
And some said clothespins. He never repaired gear nor cleaned up his boat until he had to. Consequently, he was fairly often in trouble with leaks and breakdowns. And his outfit smelled something terrible.
His shiftlessness was a byword. People behind his back, of course, nicknamed his boat the Old Tar Kettle. It was there, was even kind of folk song about him, which started,
"The old tar kettle sprung a leak and made old Craddock mad. He said to Grace, 'We'll holler in and nail on another slab.'" My grandfather had had a lifetime of keeping things shipshape. When he came home, he was pretty disgusted with Foley for the way Foley handled his rig.
He told him to his face.
A thing he shouldn't have done. For while it was good custom on the island to establish a man's reputation behind his back, you didn't just go right up to him and establish it to his face. Grandfather would have known better if he hadn't been an outlander so long.
Foley, however, merely said at the time that going skipper of all them vessels hadn't done my grandfather a mite of good. He'd come home so big feeling that you had to get a horse and team and drive hard before you could get near enough to holler to him.
For a while after Grandfather got back, he and Foley went lobstering in company. They couldn't keep up with the young fellows, though neither of them would admit it, but they could keep up with each other. They started out together early mornings and set their traps alongside. More often than not, Foley would have engine trouble and come trailing home after dark alone. When that happened, my grandfather would ride him pretty hard.
Waste of time caused by shiftlessness made no sense to him. He himself would have gotten in there by in the afternoon, sold his lobsters, and had plenty of time to scrub up his boat.
In the morning, he would shoot up alongside Foley in the harbor, his woodwork spick and span, his brass polished down to the last screw on the bow cleat.
My God, Foley, that's the only fishhawk's nest I ever seen that would float.
Now, a fishhawk keeps very bad house, as everybody knows. On some days, you can smell a fishhawk's nest a quarter of a mile, some say, to windward.
Foley would take his pipe out from between the two teeth he had left to hold it, and maybe let out a smoke cloud before he said anything.
Usually it was something mild, like...
Well, Alonzo, I know I got time to wash my lobster bait with soap and a rag.
But one day, he said...
You know, Alonzo, all you need is one of them white monkey caps and a mess of summer people. I'd know why you bother with lobstering.
And that cracked my grandfather on a mighty sensitive spot. The thing was, he might have the better boat and gear, but Foley...
But Foley caught more lobsters.
Grandfather could haul trap for trap with Foley all day long. And in the end, Foley would be highline.
He'd had a lifetime of it, and he was a natural-born fisherman, as well as knowing all the tricks.
So far, he'd never twitted Grandfather about it, but there wasn't any doubt from this remark.
After all, you don't tell a top-notch lobster catcher that all he and his boat are good for is to sail summer people.
From that time on, Grandfather's jabs at Foley got sharper. But the real trouble between them didn't begin until on Christmas morning.
When Grandfather made him a present of a ball of string wrapped up in silver paper.
As a Christmas treat, I had been allowed to go out fishing with Grandfather. And I saw him hand the package to Foley just as we were getting ready to row off to the boats in the harbor.
A lobster fisherman will swallow an insult to his wife before he will one to his boat. When Foley saw the string, which wasn't even a new ball, but a mass of odds and ends, he'd figured,
just as Grandfather had meant him to,
that it was a slur on the way he patched up his engine.
He let out a howl and flung the ball at my grandfather's head. It missed by about an inch, but Grandfather
would see the day that a man could throw a ball of string at him.
He started for Foley, and the other men on the beach had to separate them.
Foley went aboard his boat and waited to see where Grandfather was going to haul traps first. Then he went to the opposite end of his string of pots, as far away as he could get.
All day, they hauled at a distance from each other.
During the day, Grandfather cooled off some, but toward noon, the weather turned lowery and cold, with a gusty northeast wind breezing on and kicking up a cross chop.
Horsing an awkward thing like a lobster trap in over the side of a bucking, jumping boat isn't a help to any man's temper. And by the time Grandfather had done it 60 or so times, he was right back where he was. As we came smashing home past the islands, we saw Foley Craddock anchored in the channel, tinkering with his engine.
Grandfather started right on by, then realized that, after all, the weather did look pretty smurry, so he circled and went back.
He wasn't one, however, to let bygones be bygones.
Having trouble, Foley?
No, I ain't.
Hatching an egg, maybe. Well, heave up the anchor. I guess I'll stand at the tow you in. The wind will be here from me to you.
I wouldn't take a tow from you if this was hell and you was Moses flying straight to heaven.
It's coming on to a blow, and I could raise a chop in a pot if I would sink that thing.
Grandfather picked up a coil of heavy new rope he had handy, 12th thread, I think. He held onto one end and tossed the coil to Foley.
Foley hauled on the 12th thread until he had it all except about a fathom and a half, chopped it off with his bait knife and threw it overboard. If I'm going to sink, I don't want to be tied up by no Atlantic cable and no waterlogged old flounder.
The quality of these insults was not lost on my grandfather.
The flounder is a fish that lives on the sea bottom.
Also, in Foley's opinion, thus made clear, 12 thread was too bulky a rope for everyday purposes, and it followed the mark of an overcautious, inexperienced landlubber.
My grandfather got roaring mad.
Sink then, sink. Sit there in your damn pumpkin seed and sink.
I'd rather set out a nor'easter in this pumpkin seed than tow home behind God Almighty's yacht full of brass buttons.
This was going too far, even for an old friend. My grandfather made as if to go aboard a Foley and finish out the fight. But with the cross chop running, that was impossible. He started up his engine and left Foley sitting where he was.
By the time he got home, he was still so mad he couldn't eat his supper. After the meal, he didn't go right to bed, as he was his custom on stormy nights.
He sat hunched up in his rocker with his stocking feet in the oven, and everyone but me thought he was sick. The night had come on pitch dark, blowing a gale northeast and snowing. About 10 o'clock, we heard somebody walk up on the porch and stamp the snow off his feet. It was Ed Forrest, our neighbor and first selectman.
You see anything of Foley this afternoon out hauling? Seems he ain't got in.
I was told that old fool he'd get his tail in a crack if he didn't fix up that rig of his.
Yeah, but it's a bad night, Alonzo. Boys thought you might run out of an idea where he was before it shut in thick.
With great dignity, my grandfather got up from his chair and began to haul on his oilskins.
Hey, ain't no use going after him now. We'll have to wait for daylight. It's now bright night is zero and thick snow.
What do you freshwater sailors need to go out in? High noon of a stark calm day?
Well, no, but now ain't the time.
Grandfather stamped his feet to settle his boots and started for the door.
Alonzo,
said my grandmother,
don't do nothing foolish.
He turned, holding the door ajar so that the wind could drive some fine whirling snowflakes into the room and everyone could see just how bad it was out in that storm. His sou'wester was jammed down so far that he had to tilt back his head to glare at us.
I suppose you think it was daylight when I sailed some of them vessels I sailed through some of them northeasters. I could name them. I suppose none of you around here ever heard of a compass or a dead reckoning. Well, it wasn't, and you ain't.
The door slammed behind him so hard it made the lamps gutter.
Heaven's sake, what ails the old gentleman?
I know. He's been cross-grained all evening. I wish you'd go after him, Ed, and see he don't kill himself.
Well, I will, but I ain't going to get close to him.
My grandfather and Ed Forrest, with Foley Craddock, got back to land around 2 o'clock in the morning. They blew into our house, literally, on a gust of wind, for the northeaster was really tooling by then. They built a roaring fire in the stove, stripped off their soaked and frozen clothes, and sat around drinking hot buttered rum until almost daylight. Nobody was hurt or damaged or even the worse for wear, except my grandfather. The thumb on his left hand was badly frozen, and the first joint of it was gone, nipped off, clip and clean.
Ed Forrest told us the story later, I suppose saving grandfather the trouble.
Ed said he followed grandfather to the shore and got there just in time to jump into the punt with him as he was shoving off. He tried to persuade the old man not to go, but with the wind howling and grandfather cussing him out for coming, he couldn't get a word in edgeways.
The water was so rough, even in the harbor, that they almost swamped the punt. And by the time they got into the lee of grandfather's boat, they were sitting in 6 inches of water and soaked to the skin.
Beats me how the old gentleman even got us out to the morn, for it was blacker than a mouse hole under a woodpile and snowing so hard you could have walked on it.
But they got aboard all right. And Grandfather lit a little lantern he had rigged up and shaded just right to throw the light on his compass. Then he started the engine, and Ed went up on the bow, cast off.
The old gentleman took a bearing on the compass and got the time from his watch. Then he opened up the throttle and sent the boat down the channel, wide open. I never would have done it. I never would have dast put her in like that.
They drove down the channel that way for 33 minutes and a half. Ed knew the exact length of time because my grandfather told him.
33 minutes and 30 seconds. If Foley ain't gone adrift, here's where you ought to be.
Ed said he never would have believed it if he hadn't seen it with his own eyes.
Blacker than the inside of an old maid's placket and thick snow, and you couldn't see your hand before your face. And we lit the big lantern and waved it and hollered, and there, by God, fully was.
You never would have known the old tar kettle, Ed said. She was iced up so. But there she was, and Foley was all right.
He even had a line all rigged up to his bow cleat so he could heave it to us when we hove alongside. It wasn't any use to try to take him aboard with the sea running, so we figured we'd have to tow him in. He had a time cutting loose from his anchor up there on the bow, and it a glare of ice. And I was glad it wasn't me. But he finally done it, and we put in for home with him in tow. The thing was, the rope he had for the tow line wasn't strong enough, and on the way it busted three times. That's why we was so long getting back, and that's how it was the old gentleman lost his thumb.
It seems that every time Foley's boat parted the tow line, they had to circle and pick him up, gaff the loose end, and make it fast again to their stern cleat. The last time this happened, the tow line was pretty short. My grandfather didn't have enough slack to work with, and while he was making fast, the line caught his thumb, spang between it and the cleat, and the jumping boats did the rest. At least that's how Grandfather figured it. His thumb was frozen stiff at the time, and he didn't even know it was gone until he got home and into the house and took off his mitten.
By God, Foley, look at that. My thumb's gone.
Thunder and lightning. Tis, ain't it?
Tore clean off. By God, Foley, you done it.
Oh, that's right. I did, didn't I?
If I had that Atlantic cable you hove overboard this afternoon, this couldn't have happened. By God, Foley, if I had that rope end right now, I'd lay it onto you.
Well, you ain't got it.
I'd damn sight rather have lost you than that thumb.
You'd have your damn thumb if it hadn't been so soft it froze stiff and broke off like a splinter. I was out there longer than you was, and I never froze nothing, did I?
Ed said this is what they talked about while they were sitting there drinking hot buttered rum.
You guys got the lines for it.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Of Ruth's 120th birthday. We have cake out back there. We have Gus and Matthias are going to play a little bit more. So have a piece of cake and enjoy the music.
And thank you to Kathy Pratt for making this beautiful
Matthias
cake.
Lacasse.
Oh, yeah, check it out.
We're having a love time.
Gus, Gus Lacasse, remarkable fiddle player.
Isn't that great?
Yeah, Matthias.
Thank you.
It's like it's nice to have that down to you. She's pretty. You must know.
Yeah,
We're putting it on the
same time. So it's 5 to 6:30.
I'm going to go to the next one. Yeah. I got asked to, no, I don't. I didn't. I was going to say, I was asked to play by Natalia to join her in the first rendition, but it coincided with another thing, so I couldn't do it.
Oh my gosh, there really is a connection.
There is, yeah. I just wanted to tell anybody.
Oh my gosh. Well,
I want you
you finally got a chair. Woo!
It hurts, but you're going to get to a point, man, where you're like, oh, yeah.
Thank you. I will do that.
Assault charge on the person on the other side of the brick wall. And this one, yeah, he's a stone guy now.
Feel free to take a pin or a
I mean, in part, I'm making noises. Thank you. It's changed my style. More hammer, a lot of claw, but you know, stuff in the claw. When I play guitar, it's, I'm sorry, I wouldn't want to play with a pick. No. I played without a pick for like 15 years, so it's probably going to do it.
I'm shocked that you haven't broken more strings when we played together.
Yeah, I know.
There's like that was when I like when I was doing bass a long time just yeah, good.
That's what. Yes. Well, it's comfortable. That's really the only reason. Yeah.
No, I don't want to take too.
My advice is do what's most comfortable for you. A lot of, if you find that, because a lot of people like that controller. But that's not necessarily what I find. Like, it's appealing when I play. I want to be like more like, yeah, I want to really. Yeah. So I would say the answer is yes. Yeah. So, like, I would also, too, like, if you've got a bow just sat there like that, how you grab it and what you do with it is always where I decide to keep it. Because sometimes, too, I want to play with like a few fingers. Or I do. Five finger, three finger, two finger sometimes, three. Yeah, it's up. It's just how you feel.
There's no I do similarly, I do it like that. Because I just try to give the widest stance I possibly can.
just because,
yeah, and for me, I think it's because I plant my, when I play guitar, I plant my pinky. So I plant my pinky, and that's the only one that really matters. It's like pinky and the thumb are doing all the stuff. Also up high though for like the classically trained violinist that you're like.
I was classically trained by a guy who was trained by Galamian.
Thank you.
You don't need to. A lot most people don't know who he is. He was like a real stickler for technique. And like he wrote like basically a lot of the etude books. Galamian. So yeah, but yeah, it's also too like
thank you. down all he stood in an old bar. Oh, John, we all been dancing. And a boy's man came in and tapped him on the arm. Say, Johnny boy, you come and take a walk with me. Oh, Johnny, take a walk with me.
Be hauled in by the Lord Almighty's yacht. I like that one.
I was in hell if Moses was on his way to heaven.
Yeah. Oh, the best one though is the one about the giant,
I thought I'm so damn cold and froze right off brittle, or what was that? Something like that.
Yeah. Oh, how it wouldn't, because it was. You know,
it wasn't so.
Yeah, if it wasn't so soft, it froze up. I was there longer than you, and I didn't freeze up.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, God, yeah. To whoever left us this script.
Nan's been wanting to do this since she saw it. I missed it that year for some reason. I couldn't go.
I missed it, too. I was bummed about it. It's like, look good.
Yeah. I can't remember why, like, something came up. Minor emergency, and I just couldn't go.
Hey, guys, you're awesome.
Thank you. Oh, man. Coolies in the shower.
Sure.
Reckon.
Reckon.
Reckon. We're gonna try to get to that reckon.
What do you call it? The tar box, the tar bucket.
Pumpkin.
You call it a pumpkin too. I remember that.
Yeah, tar pot too.
Tar pot.
That was easily the best story of the lot.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
We had one about the old lady on the thing.
Yeah.
What's her name?
Peterson.
Peterson.
That is a true story.
What island?
Gosh.
Oh, yeah, right. Certainly not Suttons.
Did she, no, but wasn't Rachel Fields, who was a poet and writer, did she live on Suttons?
Might have done.
No. She was wonderful. She wrote a lot of different stuff,
yeah.
A lot of kids. You know, it's books.
I've heard it's good too. Of famously of accidentally Wes Anderson fame.
Oh yeah, Wes Anderson's been out there.
Well, accidentally Wes Anderson. So it's like whenever there's something aesthetically like Wes Anderson.
Oh God, it's like really.
The post office apparently. Yeah, we'll go.
Yeah.
Anybody want to come with? We'll rip some tunes.
All right. Cool.
Thank you.
I think actually a Cajun person stole it last night in the jam. Yeah, man, no worries.
Where are you working?
I'm working for a place called Taunton Bay Stone.
Okay.
So in Sullivan, at the top of the Whaleback.